information about the courses. So the basic elements that we identified that would be required, including what's up there, we have course description to start with, of course, the learning outcomes, the course topics, the hours, which translate into credits that you would award for that particular course. What prerequisites exist if your institution has set prerequisites already? Not that those are going to become a barrier, but we should know them upfront. So what's missing there would be the assignments and the evaluation of the assignments that as it currently exists at your institution. Given this fact that some of the assessments, you know, for example, the psychology course that we offer, the assessment is going to be based on a challenge exam. So the student is going to be assessed on all those individual assignments that they would normally do, taking our course and the iteration that we offer. So, but we still should see all the assessments and the evaluation rubric for those, right? Okay, so what do you say? The exit credential.
I think our discussion started to get a little higher up on the document, actually. Aren't there some other questions?
No, they're below.
Oh,
yeah, okay, the questions are below. Oh, yes, one of the questions was, is it, you know, we asked, is it necessary for all partners to articulate all courses? So that's an important question. So if, from our point of view, we need to, because we're offering that credential, but not all universities are offering a credential. However, if a student takes two of your courses, gets the certificate from TRU, but then goes back to your individual institution and says, I now want to ladder into one of your programs, I want to pursue a diploma or a degree, then yes, you are going to have to articulate those courses. Because eventually they're going to come home to you, right? And you're going to have to have a way of a mechanism or some sort of built-in way already of saying, yeah, we know those courses, we already have an agreement with TRU, they offer those courses, we accept your transcript, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? So maybe at the outset, no, right? Mm-hmm. At the outset, I think it's important for UHI and TRU to know to assess all these courses, but eventually I think everyone should.
Yeah.
So that's in their system. Do you want to add something?
I was just going to augment that
yeah.
Given that some of the courses are currently in development, we talked about how we could still populate the course outline template and have these courses articulated in advance.
Oh yeah, we don't need the full fleshed out full course. We just need those basic elements, the essential elements for a standardized course. But yeah, in our discussion, there was some tension between, you know, using that word standardizing, a standard. We don't want, again, I just want to emphasize, we're not trying to standardize all the courses. That's the institution level to offer the course. Their course is their course. We're not trying to fit everyone into the same pay, round hole, or whatever the analogy is that you want to use. Okay. Number two, about assessment services. We weren't entirely sure how to interpret this question, actually. If we, at one point, interpreted, so for example, at TRU, we have an assessment services office. We have a physical location where students can go and write an individuated exam. So if someone took the course in New Zealand or a course from wherever, and your institution contacted me and said, okay, this student needs to have their exam invigilated, will you offer those services? We would say absolutely. There's a fee the student would have to pay, but we will provide an invigilator for the student to write it physically in our institution. So that's one level of assessment services. But then we started talking about other levels of assessment services. For example, we just heard the whole presentation on ProctorU. Currently, TRU doesn't use ProctorU. I think we're looking into remote, that kind of online invigilation of exams, from what I've understood. We may go down that road someday, but also through the OERu, that might be a question as to whether does OERu become a client of ProctorU? And then through that mechanism, exams could be invigilated. Right? So we're just throwing that out there. That's a good question to consider.
We would be guided by what the partners want.
Exactly, yeah. Okay. All right, so moving on to number three, the exit qualifications. We discussed the idea that Of course, there's probably other exit qualifications that could be offered to students, and that institutions should consider what they could throw up there, what could they offer, what could be done to offer more exit qualifications. But that also linked us to the courses, the actual courses that we're offering. There's a linkage, going to be a linkage between the kind of courses that we're offering and the exit credentials. So if the more specific or the more, you know, say professionally geared credential becomes, then the more specific those courses have to become to meet the needs of an exit credential. So there's a definite link between the kinds of courses that we're offering and future courses that could be offered and potential expanding those exit credentials. Right? So we need to keep that in front of us. You can't separate the two. We talked about reminding ourselves of the blueprint from 2015. And those of you who were there, some of the folks at our table, reminded us there was a blueprint created that included some potential streams and themes for programming. And we don't want to lose that. That's important legacy discussion. So let's keep that in front of us as we move forward and even expand on possible themes and strengths around the kinds of courses that we're offering. Right now, it's quite an arbitrary list as to what's up on that list right now, but we may want to have some sort of oversight given or some thought, more thought given to what we actually offer. And then that led us into the discussion of academic oversight. And the fact that in the blueprint that we saw from last year as well, there was discussion around creating a position of academic director or something where we have a person that's part of the group through OERU that would provide some coordination for that kind of future work. Right? I think there's, you know, we're kind of on the cusp of moving over into some real work here that needs to be done. And so we're sort of anticipating that is probably an action step that we need to work on in the future. And as well with the number, question number three, we talked about English literacy requirements. And because it's an international offering, there's going to be people of various abilities coming into these courses. And we all, I think, at the table, pretty much agreed that there was probably a need for more English composition. We've got one on the list now, but most of us felt that probably 6 credits of English composition might become more of a norm. And we may, you know, I know we want to keep it open. No, you don't want to provide some barriers, but there might be a need down the road to have some sort of diagnostic built into the system that's free, where a student could go in and work on some grammar, you know, examples, work on some of you, for example, with Purdue University and their writing center, they have, I used to send my students there all the time, go and do a self-check on your grammar skills, because I can't cover every rule of grammar in an English composition class, you know. So you go in and you start studying sentence structure and you can do a test bank of 20 questions. You finish it, gives you an immediate response. Right. You know, here are the questions you got right, here are the questions you got wrong, and here's why they're wrong. You know, and so there might be some need, I think, to be talked, and Andy, I think, will jump in here too, because we feel that, you know, a person, before they start to achieve those credits or go for those assessments, we want to support student success. Mm-hmm. And we don't want to set people up for failure. So there might be some measure to sort of, it's sort of like an equalizer, if you like, to sort of say, can we kind of expect this level of literacy in order to support your success down the road? So here's some diagnostics you can perform for free, not for testing, and see what your results are. And if you don't get a satisfactory result, then it might trigger an email or something to that student saying, hey, good job for trying, but I think there's room for improvement here. And so we want to support success as you move through our courses, and here's some ways in which you can self-educate. You know, and of course, there's a whole principle behind this to say, here's a person who perhaps wants to. We're hoping that's the case. So action steps moving forward in terms of decision recommendations, sort of reminding ourselves of the programs and streams, which is up there. Sort of again, creating a template for courses is to standardize the elements. Which I already alluded to, the course topics, learning outcomes, assessments, course description, etc. Pursue the idea of building or developing additional courses to possibly link to streams that could ladder into professional credentials or further degree options for students. You know, it sort of felt at our table that there's it's one thing just to offer a whole bunch of courses, that's great, but what does it actually mean? Where could a student go with it? You know, sort of having that conversation. English literacy, again, perhaps adding another specific English composition or study of literature or something, another class that or course that may or may not become mandatory, I don't know. And then the assessment piece, sort of actually create a database of partners who actually already have assessment services built into their institutions where we could physically support offering assessments, or let's maybe further that conversation around online assessment tools and whether that becomes a standard feature of OERu and that we all can sort of buy into, if you like. So anyone else from my group, please feel free to add any more anything that I might have forgotten.
Very comprehensive.
Yeah.
Can I just offer a thought at this point? I'm behind the curve on all this stuff. This is my first meeting with OERu. It sounds like there's a lot of stuff that you've just described that needs to be put in place to do this. And the thought I have is just that I wonder if there's a danger of basically recreating the entire system in the institution so that it maps nicely. You're going to have to do so much extra work. Is that the plan? Is that the idea?
I think what is actually happening here is a process of validation to make sure that what we're doing in OERu fits in with existing systems and policies at the institutions that are conferring. So it's that conversation, that mapping conversation, in terms of in what way does the information need to be presented so that it functions within the existing policy. Yeah. So it's not so much about creating a whole bunch of stuff. I think the real creation is really just the course information is reported in a way that articulates its systems.
Yeah. I guess maybe it's just that the critical path is still a long path. Maybe that's it.
Oh, yeah. This is minimum viable color. We're only doing it for a small bit now. Sure. Okay, good question.
It just seems like, I'm just trying to get my head clear on there's all different sorts of validation standards and the different institutions as well. So I had to go through that entire process for every individual institution. It just seems to me to be a lot of stuff.
The tension is how much standardization is actually beneficial.
Exactly, yeah.
I don't know whether that's a theoretical question or an empirical question, but it seems to me that there needs to be some kind of fairly short template which says this is what the course is about, this is how many learning hours it is, this is what level it is, such that you can feed it into the system. So I think it's we were talking about the fact that I think it is an interesting time in higher education because globalization, the increased collaboration between institutions, increased pressure from quality agencies of various kinds is pushing us to be much more explicit about stuff. I was just saying this to Wayne and Clive before, I feel we're kind of reaching a point of crystallization in higher education where we really actually have to engage with the architecture by which we describe what we do so that we can collaborate more easily. We might not be quite at that point yet, but I think one of the intriguing possibilities for this group is to seed some of that work or to be able to set some standards. But the risk is that you disappear up your own.
Look, actually, Andy, I'd love to work on that with you. I've been thinking about that for a while. As I mentioned in that group before, it's something like that, the networking, seven layers of networking protocol, but not that many, but for education, so that we have a common language. Because even as people are speaking, I recognize that we're not really aware of each other's systems. They're very different.
And, a question, if I was a government minister or if I was sitting in Treasury in one of the countries, I'd say, why are you guys doing this stuff 2,000 different ways when you're basically all doing the same thing? And, that's the risk for us in higher education. I think if we don't find some efficiencies and some decent standards of our own, someone will give them to us or they will replace us with something that has them. That's the risk I see.
And that's our opportunity, really.
Yeah, I think it is.
Okay, so shall we take feedback from group two then? which was looking at the sort of the due diligence activity list for preparing for launch, and I believe there's a launch date that has been proposed.
Oh.
I'm happy to read what we did if people want me to, or I think maybe some possibly more perhaps more qualified to provide more commentary, or maybe all of you can jump in when I try to explain what we've got here. So give you all the key bit of information, we've decided on a date for launch of the MVP. We're talking about doing a not a massive media circus, but just a relatively understated launch, just to avoid unnecessary embarrassment. But if should anything go wrong, but it won't. So 15th of March is the day, and we also
None of us are suspicious at all.
Yeah, it's my birthday. Is it?
Oh.
Yeah, so it should be all right? Okay. So we've got Mark's approval done. All right. We just want to, what we want to do is we want for people to have a better taste in their mouth about that day. Aside from Mark, of course. So yes, we're trying to restore it to its more neutral grandeur. And so we also decided then the 15th of January would be the day to start actually marketing this so that we actually have students ready to participate on the 15th. So just to go back, we decided that the due diligence requirements needed to be broken down into who actually has responsibility for undertaking them. We determined that the OERU, and please, as I said, jump in and correct me if I'm not giving enough information or the wrong information. For OERU itself, as a collective, we said that we have to remind all of the participating institutions that that they have the obligation to clear copyright on all the materials that are stored there. We talked about needing to provide a date for marketing, which we've done, actually. We need information for learners, comprehensive information for learners, in a generic form or sort of a boilerplate, including the definition of terms of all of the things that would be relevant to their participation in the MVP, which can then be varied by individual institutions, which you'll see a little bit there. So that includes things like the nature of the relationship between learners and institutions, the expectations of their timing for delivering materials and so on, delivering assessment materials, that kind of thing. We also looked at the individual institutional responsibilities, so things like the fact that courses are fully proofed and ready to go by that date. I think we also talked about having a margin of safety as well, so we might have an earlier date for all of that kind of thing to be completed that we haven't decided on yet, but probably in a month I would probably put out. That all materials are cleared for copyright infringement on a per institution basis. The details of how students will register and what fees will be applicable and methods for payment need to be sorted out beforehand. Any variations from the boilerplate that I mentioned above with regard to the specific nature of the relationship between learners and the institutions, and any changes to the terminologies and so on. Also information related to the program information, I think is how you described it, that's like prerequisites or the combinations of micro courses that need to be taken to be credit, is that right? Okay. And so any institutional specific lore that needs to be, learners need to be aware of. There's also the responsibility on institutions to ensure that their details are kept up to date throughout the process so that when students look at them, or when learners look at them, they're looking at the ballot. That's an obligation on, by institutions. And the recognition that courses that are completed will be available for transcript credit with that institution, so that's an implicit obligation. And then we also had, I just noted that there were some responsibilities that learners had as well, things like because they could participate in a course without explicitly enrolling in any or having any contractual relationship with the institutions running the course, any course, that it was their responsibility to maintain all of the relevant materials that would be required for assessment at the end and be able to deliver those. And so I'm not entirely sure whether we need to flesh that out a bit more. And that they would also then have to arrange their contract with the assessing organ, assessing institutions, and it was on them to achieve that. And I think we had, yeah, we also talked about things that we would want to see happening to help promote the success of an MVP, namely identify learner ambassadors that we could potentially work with to develop stories of how they participate or what their participation was like, so that we could use that as a basis for marketing to future learners as well. And ideally also similarly looking for case studies from educators and institutional representatives.
Yeah. Are you envisioning, or is someone envisioning, a sort of a portal for all the institutions, you know, that some centralized portal, an OERu portal, or is this material stuff that we would be responsible for maintaining on our own websites and that sort of thing?
We would maintain the central OERu site, which would give the information on articulation to the various programs, the prices, that sort of thing. Of course, partner institutions will have password access to the CMS to keep that information up to date. But one of the agreed, you recall from last year, we agreed that there would be one portal that learners go to in order to get into the courses as part of our MVP definition. You may want to change that in the future, that's fine. But for MVP, that's what we can work with, yeah.
And as far as maintaining the specific information for each institution, we would have access to the
absolutely, portal. Absolutely. Because if you decide to change your pricing, because that's your decision,
yeah,
you must have the ability to, you know, to make those changes.
Right.
So you would have the responsibility for keeping your own information up to date. Yeah. Okay.
Might be good to try to set it up so we can try to glean the information from our own web pages.
You can always refer back to your own information as well.
I'm nervous about it, but we let's explore.
Yeah.
Just a caution around prerequisites. We talked about the issue of prerequisites in our group as well, and there was, you know, sort of a concern there that, you know, do prerequisites come into play? At what point do they come into play? They really shouldn't come into play, because if a student is doing a course because they want to do a course and they're not pursuing those credentials, who cares?
Just a word of caution. I put the term prerequisites in there because that's what I interpreted, but I may have incorrectly invoked.
So typically,
we
have to be guided by the partner institution's requirements for credit transfer,
exactly.
And those are the prerequisites that would be stated on the OERu course site. Of course, it's being, you know, we've got the high-level course descriptions, which is more the marketing blurb of the courses. So if there are any prerequisites or language requirements or whatever, those are determined by the institution that's doing the assessment around that course, and that has to be there.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, any learner is free to participate should they want to, and maybe in the future they meet the prerequisite requirements.
I just think it's a really delicate point, because you don't want it to be off-putting to people. They see a prerequisite, I go, oh, wow, like, I don't have that, you know. Or at the same time, should they even be there? You know, like, I'm just throwing that out there as an action step that we need to talk about.
It's a conversation we need to have.
Yeah, and that falls into the academic oversight again.
Yeah.
I think we need to be careful. These aren't students. They're learners, people on the web. We have no legal obligation towards them. They go and take the course. When they come and take your test, then it's up to your legal jurisdiction or whatever, whether they're students or whether they're just people coming in to take the test. And I think it's important that you
know, that's a very important point, Rory. And you'll actually see in the OERU terms of reference that the language is learner.
Yes.
And there's a clear distinction that you're not a student until the point that you have a contractual relationship with the assessing institution.
Yes.
Yeah.
And this is the third time that I said we need a page showing that these universities will accept credit from any of the other partners and the list.
Yeah.
And it wasn't, I thought you wrote it down, but I asked to write it down because I think it's really important that we have that, that there are some institutions will accept transfer credit, others can't. But I think there should be a list of those that.
I can allay some of your fears, Rory. It's in fact a stated KPI for 2016. The reason we haven't done it yet is because we haven't got the relevant information to put on the site. So I'm hopeful that we will achieve the KPI by the end of the year, so a few more months.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's important.
It was actually included in one of the kind of variations on the boilerplate definitions that every institution would list the transfer credits that they would accept, or the institutions from which they would accept transfer credits.
Yeah, but I specifically said a page where it shows these institutions will accept transfer credit from the other participating partners, and there's a few of institutions that will do that, and some won't. So I think it's important that students know which ones that they can work with on that basis.
It also might prompt those institutions who will not accept the credit
to think again
and reconsider their decision.
Okay, moving on then. And David's recording that it's
there now.
It will happen.
It's there now.
Because you'll hammer me at the next board meeting about that.
Well, I don't like it as I said earlier, in Canadian meetings, when they all agree, that doesn't really mean they agree at all. It just means they're being polite.
I agree.
Okay, so the next breakout session is really to start thinking a little about our KPIs and operational priorities for the forthcoming year. I must say that the due diligence list, in fact, I think is the list of kind of KPIs we need to get done by 2017. I'm going to put forward that I actually use that as the initial draft for the KPIs, shaping up the KPIs for 2017. As opposed to spending a lot of time deliberating that here, I mean, our open planning model, it will be just, you know, uploaded in the wiki as we progress, so that everyone will have the opportunity to comment. The other two issues, and this is again a sign of our maturity, we had some discussion about this yesterday in one of the groups, this is whole question of academic oversight. I think the network is getting to the point now where we need more robust mechanisms of academic oversight in building our curricula. You know, it's what courses do we target, you know, what streams do we need to have. And one of the proposals that came up in the consultation preparing the agenda for this meeting was to establish an OERU academic board. Now, whether it's going to be called that or not called that, or whether we go forward with the concept, we're not sure, right? But the point is, we will have a breakout group now to actually discuss that very issue in terms of how do we achieve academic oversight within the OERU, or if that is something we actually need.
Well, I can we discuss whether we need it or not. Our university has academic oversight. We're not interested in other people's academic oversight. We'll keep that, our independence on that on our own.
Absolutely.
And that's whatever OERU has on academic oversight, go ahead if others want it, but I can't see why we would do that.
Absolutely. I think the language that was used yesterday, this is a toothless tiger. And I think the question is, how many teeth does a toothless tiger need to have?
I can't understand what purpose this can serve.
It serves the purpose to guide the OER Foundation in terms of how we go out and recruit courses. How do we fill the gaps?
It'd be something more like a program advisory.
Program advisory.
Is that the concept?
Program coordination, whatever.
Oh, okay, well.
That's different.
Yes.
Yeah.
It looks quite different.
I like the word suggestion.
So that's in fact the first recommendation, don't call this thing. Yeah, absolutely. But anyway, there will be a group discussing that, and what has happened, there are a draft set of guidelines. Now, again, you'll see that the guidelines that have been established are in fact those of toothless tigers. That's the wrong page, sorry. Good for the session. Right, here we go. So it won't be called academic board. I was guided by what the meeting told me. It won't be called academic board. We decided that. But there are these, there's just a draft set of guidelines, and this is in open source tradition. We talk about straw dog proposals. These are ideas to be shot down. Okay, it's really the starting point of a discussion. To have a look at these things, is this the kind of thing, are these the kind of things that something like this needs to do? How is it assembled? How does it work? What you will see here is a very clear statement. No powers have been delegated to this thing that's not the academic board by OER department institutions. So this is not trying to usurp authority of any institution. It's really about academic oversight and coordination and advice for the network. So there will be a group discussing this, and we're looking for recommendations. What do you want to throw out? Do we make this thing happen? Do we do something else? Okay. The second group, and our very first meeting, because now that we're moving into the actual teaching phases of the OERu with MVP, there is the question of what can OERu do to ensure the best, to ensure student support to the levels that we can in a model that doesn't provide tutorial support, right? What can we do to improve learner support within our delivery model? And one of the ideas that was proposed very early on with the inception of the OERu was this concept of academic volunteers international. And I think now is the time in our journey in building this OERu that we should start revisiting that conversation and have a look at, you know, ideas and suggestions of how we might actually look at the student support issue. So those are the two groups for this session. Just a rough show of hands. Who wants to talk about what's not going to be the academic board? Okay, so the academic oversight piece, great. Rory, you'll keep them in tow, right?
I'll keep an eye on.
Good. And then so then the student support is studying. So I guess the student support part of the phone. Is there someone? Andy, are you student support? So you've got a key thingy?
Yep.
Perfect. So then we'll have the student support people on the other side, and we will report back here at 12:45. So we've got a good bit of time to get this sorted.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no, I'm
student support.
Yeah, I'm down here.
Perfect. Academic board, I suppose I'll stay here with academic board. Or maybe,
So what you're doing is...
I guess everyone at the end is going to get it. The equal board meetings, yeah.
Super high heels, especially, all right? We are.
Yes.
We are.
Yeah, we need more of those basic courses, chemistry, science.
Yeah.
Introductory biology, those are the type of courses.
And well, the trouble is it doesn't help, you know, OER foundation can't say that stuff, the network has to say that stuff.
It's basically.
It's part of the.
So meetings, actually meetings, so that redirects you to work with the course.
I'm intrigued about the composition of the architect.
You were there already.
Because the vast majority of the academics are kind of like this.
Yeah, that's strange.
Talk to you about different groups, different tables.
You're so good.
But I'll let someone else, I'll let someone else do the description as well, that's quite up the alley, my definition as well.
Yeah, maybe we should nominate a rapporteur. They will keep minutes.
Thanks.
Andy is accepting.
I still need to get to the right page.
So there's a draft, maybe I should put that up on the screen then.
The draft terms are in.
Draft terms are in, and really that was just a mind dump, it's a starting point. It's a straw dog, it's there to be shot down.
So one question I was thinking about earlier on is, does OERu need to decide anything in terms of what a course looks like? Does it just need to help institutions decide what courses look like? Because OERu is not.
I think in an institutional sense.
Which I guess is your point, Rory.
Nobody's going to tell us what our courses look like.
Yeah. We can have your courses when we're discussing your whole day thing as we go.
I wouldn't dare go to any academic in our university and tell them what this course is going to look like.
Unless it has to have learning outcomes.
Sorry, I'm. Courses or programs.
So there's a link.
There you go.
On day two.
Courses or programs.
Yeah, day two, there's a link to the draft terms of.
Sorry, I wonder if we report that. So terminology, when we're talking courses, we're talking individual module.
Oh, it's an explicit.
So the language that's been used in OERu is a course is the thing that makes up a degree.
Correct.
So it's not a micro course. A micro course is the components that make up a full course.
A degree is the entire, is an assembly of the course.
Of courses, however, at UHI, a course needs to be something different. A module is what we talk about as a course.
Yes, and we.
We talk about subject as a course.
We talk about subjects and courses, meaning programs, degrees.
Yeah.
Courses.
Is the program, you talk about a course and then there's two different things. Yeah, and I think we got messed up on term. She's not here. Yeah, the terminology this morning when she was talking about UHI, she was, to me, she was equating. She was using the word program, but she really meant course.
Yeah.
So we need to get our head around correct terminology.
We actually do have a set of a glossary where these things have been kind of defined in terms of how we use it in the OERu. Yeah.
To go back to Rory's point, I don't think there's no presumption that OERu would be trying to dictate what's outside.
Oh, absolutely not.
But there is a role, presumably, for some cross-institutional comment on program.
Yes.
Or is there? Or,
no,
or
I,
yeah.
I mean, I see this body really as a coordinating body, really just coordinating what are the courses, and they're not looking at, not making the decision going to anyone, to TRU, for example, saying, you need to create a course in sociology, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
That's, and then I present a course and someone says, oh, no, that's not what we meant. But that's not where we're going with this. We're not going down to that level at all.
No.
We're really looking at the big, the higher level,
yep.
You know, the actual full course list and then coordinating, do we develop streams, themes, working with the partners, working with what the decisions the partners made. It's all built on consensus here. So I don't see, to me, I don't see this board as having autonomy from the partners.
Okay.
The board is going to be made up of partners.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, but I think the key thing that you said there was coordinating role, and this is in no way an approval mechanism. It's, as I see it, the identifying opportunities, but perhaps also has a role in preventing duplication of effort among the partners.
That's a good point.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If I could add something to that, I think. You know, the other group right now is talking about a student support function. It seems to me that it would really fill a needed role if it were to be the academic support group. In other words, one of the things I've noticed that a lot of our institutions have trouble with is thinking about how to implement this at home, whether it's because we're only sending one representative or the wrong people in the room or something. What seems to me that this group could really do would be to help each institution develop a model in which this could work, considering all of the different requirements and rules that they have back at home, you know, while keeping true to the original goals and the model of the OERu as a whole, you know, so almost as a consulting or consultative body, if you will, that would still be able to understand what everyone is doing, you know, but would then be able to help you, here's a path that we would recommend for you that would help you to be a full active member of this group.
Yeah,
so it's kind of the academic support and coordination group.
Like a hub.
Yeah.
You know, like, for example, we're talking about articulation of courses. And like I said, it's essential that we articulate every course, but not necessarily essential that everyone articulate every course.
Right.
But if there's a body or a board that keeps track of that, in other words, if I sent them a database and said, okay, we've articulated, here's a database that shows every course and how it's going to articulate a tier, someone has to. I need to send that to someone. It shouldn't be you. You guys already have enough work, right?
Yeah.
This is an aside from what the work you're already doing. And then someone coordinates that and then messages out to everyone saying, okay, here's what's been done so far. So here's what's left to do.
Yeah.
You know, that whole idea of what do we have to do? What have we done? What's left to do?
Yeah.
You know, just, I don't know. I don't see this as superseding anything at the university level.
Oh, absolutely not.
We all have our own academic approval system. And no one's trying to circumvent that or change that.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And that's the core principle of engagement of OERu. Institutions retain autonomy. In all aspects of this, it's very important.
Community support.
Yeah. So that's very clear. The recommendations that came out of our group, there was totally the wrong name. So what are we, the academic support and coordination group?
Program group.
Program
support. Just to blend
program advisory.
Just looking at the program. We're not looking at the academics. We're looking at the program.
Yeah.
Yeah. Curriculum advisory.
Assuming we all have the same idea of a program as being a group of courses leading the way.
Exactly. There's a distinction between a course and a program.
Yeah.
As opposed to courses. Yeah.
So advisory group is useful. I mean, because the other area sitting in here, and I think it relates to the point you made earlier on, to avoid duplication, in theory, it is possible for a group like this to say, well, okay, here are a bunch of quality standards, not to impose on any institution, but here are a bunch of quality standards that we agree to, that an OERU course looks like, and there's a collegial vetting process from the network. Our colleagues and peers say, well, okay, it meets those standards that OERU has set. It then means that we don't have to replicate. If an institution opts in and says, well, okay, we accept and trust that collegial process, right? We don't have to replicate the individual articulation for every single course at every single institution, for the institutions who choose to opt into that. Okay. I'm just thinking a little bit, you know, down the track a little bit. Yeah.
It's something you can draw upon if you need it.
If you want to do it, that's fine. Because I know our institution would want to do something. I mean, you wouldn't want to articulate every single course.
So the terminology we're just talking about, program advisory group?
Curriculum, or is it just advisory group?
I'm just thinking curriculum might take some of the same angles that.
Yeah, and also the different usages of the term in different parts of the world. Program advisory group, I think.
Spelling a program that causes problems.
Drop the ME,
it doesn't. Double ME.
We've decided.
We could just call it advisory group and sidestep the issue. Does the group have a broader scope, perhaps, than simply looking at program or
yeah, it's a good question.
Well, if it does, it does. It doesn't matter what you call it.
Things may
you call it a program advisory board, and let's get on to the discussion.
Board or group?
Not a group.
Who cares? Like, we're going to spend 20 minutes on this.
And I think that the function and the responsibilities and the rationale will evolve. I mean, we can say right now what we expect it would be identified or what we can predict what's been responsible for, but I think as things evolve, that may shift. And it may not need to be, this could be ad hoc, it could not be needed 2 years down the road. Right?
Absolutely.
So I think all options are kind of on the table at this point.
Absolutely.
I think not defining it too much means we're not putting constraints on it.
So the TOR that we've got here are really much more like a traditional conception of an academic.
Yeah, and
as you said, that's
where it comes from, and we can reject all of that stuff. Yeah.
Wayne, what's the problem that this committee is trying to solve here? What's the problem?
Academic oversight on, not in the institutional sense, but kind of in the OERU sense.
Oversight of what?
Just the program. So far
the program.
Yeah.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's a program advisory board. So let's look at the program. So where are we going with the program? We've got a general studies program and a nascent business program, right?
Yep.
And so what you want to know is where are we going from here?
Yep.
And, well, I'll put a suggestion on the table that we go for the business program and get towards a Bachelor of Business, because I think that's the cash cow. That would be my proposal. And we already have, what, about 10 business courses at the preliminary first year, second year levels. And the general studies will just take care of itself. As if you put in a course, just put them in and they can take some business courses, some of it, whatever. I think the general studies will just happen organically.
This is where program advisory group is very useful, because I can assure the area where it's been hardest to secure courses has been business.
Because
business people think they can make money.
They all class themselves as entrepreneurs, whether they are or not. And they want to make money out of it. That's very true.
And as part of that, it's that sort of bilateral communication between this entity, which is OERU, this network, and what's happening on campus, because there is a communication gap there.
Mm.
And is this a vehicle to improve that or not?
But
But let's, you know, if I think about, you know, OL, I have 700 faculty campus, there's probably about 800 faculty.
Yeah.
There may be 10 people across the whole university that actually care about this.
Yeah.
And to be perfectly honest, given faculty relations with our campus-based faculty, this is the sort of stuff that I actually don't want to go, bam, here's the pie in the face, guys, and this is what we're doing. Because they may come back and say, actually, you violated the collective agreement by taking work away from one of our campus-based faculty people.
Yeah.
So I think part and parcel, and that, I think this is something for the chief executives to have a conversation about is, what is it that we actually want to get to? If it is to actually have a BBA or what have you, that's the ultimate goal that we want to get to. Then we work backwards from there, and I think that's where you actually start to look at what this program advisory group actually is going to do. Because if I look at it from my own internal structures and the different types of structures we have at Thompson Rivers, no, you're not going to tell me how the program is, the general studies program is going to be structured, because this is our credential. And we have to get that through, and people need to meet that. And we can be very open and flexible. And it is extraordinarily open and flexible. And we will try and make it even more open and flexible. But I think we're going to start to butt up against some of the governance structures as well. Not to mention, I think, going back again, I'm new at this one, but what is it that our ultimate goal is, and when do we want to be there?
Can I come in there? Can I give you a chief executive's perspective?
Absolutely.
I've brought two universities into the OERu, one from Wales and one from Scotland. There are a significant number of threats facing higher education. And we're all aware of those, and they're global in that. And there are some universities that are deeply involved in this, in some of the, you know, like the OU with Future Learning and all of these things. And institutions that have got much more resource than we've got as individual institutions.
Right.
Now, the reason I came into it, brought the two universities in, was one, I thought, actually, it is the right thing to do, but I'm not completely altruistic. I actually see this as a potential revenue source for the institution that nests within a global context and a global network. But it's also a relatively low-risk approach. I'm not having to find millions and millions of dollars to invest through this. But I think what we're going to have to do at some point is we have to get some sort of product that the marketplace wants. Now, if we go ahead and somebody's saying about business, and business is the cash cow. All the business learning programs around the world will show you the biggest thing is business studies. So that's an obvious market. You know, if you want to try and take some of that, rather trying to create a market. The problem is that we provide a product that nobody wants very quickly. All the enthusiasm and everything is going to dissipate very quickly, and you'll lose members. You know, if we go out with something that is not really attractive to the marketplace, and we recruit 10, 15 people, and it doesn't seem to budge, and then I have to say to myself, well, what's my institution doing? We tried it, it's not working, I'll use that resource elsewhere. So I think it's vitally important that we do have something that has got a good market presence. And for me, it's a low risk approach for my institution to do this.
So I was wondering, what actually, I mean, a part of the work for this group actually is a market assessment piece, isn't it? It's trying to understand whether, you know, exactly your question, is there actually something that's going to thrive out there, or are we just throwing things together that are not going to be interesting?
Exactly. What you've got to do is you've got to look at existing markets. So if I'm not a marketeer, I'm a biomedical scientist, so in data science. But when you look at it, you look at what Samsung did to Nokia. Nokia were the dominant players in telephones for years. Samsung saw that market, said, actually, we want to take a bit of that. In the existing market there, we don't want to take 5%. They took a lot more than 5%. You know, basically destroyed Nokia. So they saw there was a market there. And they said, let's take a bit of that, rather than trying to create a new market.
Another example of that is that the Kodak invented the digital camera, and they refused to release it because it would affect their main business. And look what happened there.
The market leaders never see the disruption coming because they've got too much invested. it's the Upton Sinclair statement. Yeah. You can't get someone to understand something that it depends on them not understanding.
But to answer Christine's question of, you know, what the goal is for us, I don't think there is an ultimate goal. I think we're going to put programs together. And we originally thought general studies was the low hanging fruit. I agree that business is a real possibility in the market. What's next? I don't know. Let's look health studies, depending on what the different partners say, but as many programs as we can. And I don't see it ever ending. I see it as expanding all the time and bringing in new programs as we grow.
But what is interesting here, there's clearly a strong strategic element in this discussion. And given yesterday's thinking around some of the rationalization of the working groups, maybe this is something that needs to be combined with kind of the strategic planning group.
Because there's, you know, I think the Kodak, certainly I'm older than it, the Kodak moment is prominent in most vice chancellors' minds, particularly those of us who've got significant distance education. So, you know, 2/3 of our students are in distance, so we are extremely worried about our market being eaten by new entrants. The potential through this actually is to find a different cost base model where you could be successful. And, you know, the one thing we're not good at in higher education is reusing resources. So, I mean, that's, from my perspective, exactly what Pride said. But also, there are some potentially interesting models in here which we could control rather than having somebody else eat our existing business. So, there are a number of things that you can do with a vehicle that it actually, you know, sort of twist that metaphor a bit more, the vehicle actually needs to have wheels on to be able to drive.
Yes. But we started, we agreed on the first year model. And we did that because, again, we can get a certificate that has some cachet and bring students in. But now, as part of our program, we should be now looking at the second year, because get the first year out, but we should already be starting on the second year, third year, fourth year. And the business program or any other that we decide would be the one, but it doesn't even matter if you decide. I mean, if University of Highlands and Islands and Athabasca and some other universities start putting in business courses, it'll happen anyway.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we don't all have to agree. Things are going to develop organically. But I think there's a benefit in looking at the big picture of where we're going.
I mean, this does have to come back to income and money, because we can't afford to do this for free forever.
Absolutely.
But what we mustn't lose, and I don't think we are, is the fact that we're providing an affordable type of education in a new model across the world. And that fits with public education and universities and all of that. So we wouldn't want to lose that. But at the same time, we have to be successful enough to give it that push to get it going.
So I think it's great when executives understand that and can make the case for their whole institution that this is something that's necessary and that it's not going to lose you money in the way that it looks like it would from the outside. That seems like an important role for this group that we're discussing here to play at translating what we all know for the folks back home, you know, because there's not always someone like you who can go out and address the folks and make the case, you know. And some of that is making the case for the business model. Some of it's making the case for it as a pedagogical approach or a different way of interacting with learners. Maybe it's a recruiting tool or something, but it's not self-evident to most of the people I work with, you know. And that seems like something that if we don't do that, we can create all sorts of courses and all sorts of degrees, you know, programs of study, and throw them over the wall, and no one will know what this thing is.
So just from a process point of view, we're not going to, the TOR we have probably don't fit.
That's
fine. So
that's a decision we can take and say, no, this is no good, this is not what we need, we need this other thing.
Yeah, and so the other, how does that get done? Is that something that gets done after? We're not going to talk through that now.
The idea here is, I mean, I think how it might work is to say, well, okay, we have a couple of bullet points to say, well, okay, this is what this thing is, right? And then we task a couple of folk within the network to shape this up, done openly and transparently. We have the consultation again, but it's about moving that conversation forward and doing our best to have the right people at the table having that conversation.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a program in marketing. Well, it's a marketing function to it as well, effectively.
Yep.
Market assessment.
Yep.
How do we decide who's on this council? What are we calling it again?
Program advisory group. Oh, and it could be a group. It doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to be a council. It doesn't have to be that formal. Just
well, how
for the record, I've lost my network connection, so I haven't been able to.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how do you decide the makeup of a group? How has it been done in the past?
But I'm still struggling a little as to how this would differ from the CEO's group. If we're talking about overall strategic direction and KPIs to be mapped out for, say, the next 5 years, how is that different?
Well, my thought is I'm not going to have the time to do all of that thinking, so somebody from our institution could understand better what the opportunities are in terms of what can be put together. Well, you know, it's the answer is, can't do it all. So we're looking for advice from somebody and we want the right people to give that advice.
This one of what Clara was saying, giving a viable market product and coming to call it the market if you want to with compelling offering. How do we determine what the market needs? Do we say we know the market needs the following? Do we do any kind of market research or analysis of what the needs are? Could this program advisory board sort of function in terms of trying to do some kind of assessment of where needs are for global educational programs? We have a role in that.
That's a good question. I think that's such a that's such a big job to take on. For us, I was struck last year when we were in South Africa how differently this fits into the higher ed landscape there. You know, supposed to wear this here, and I could be an expert, and I'm not in marketing in the U.S. higher ed. I could not go to South Africa and explain to you how to do this. But maybe just having a series of questions that we put where we look. Have you considered this? What's your change management approach, and what it would.
So the interesting thing with the OERu. With an open model is our cost structures of actually going to market are very low and they're very low risk. It would be cheaper for us to put a course out there to test the market than what it would be to actually conduct market research.
It's not only that, market research is only good for in industries where they're around for a while. If it's something new like we're doing, there's no market study, you know, like I mean, we had to go around in the early 1990s. We wanted to create a web designer program, one of the first anywhere. And they asked us, well, you have to do a market study, the government said, if you to do it. And I mean, we had to go around and ask people, would you like to hire a web designer? Nobody knew what it was. I mean, but web design is one of the highest growing jobs around now. So, I mean, it's the same thing. There's no market study. You do what you just said, is put it out there and see what happens.
But as we discussed previously, the potential advantage is that it's free-ish, but there's still a lot of, as we're experiencing, there's a lot of effort goes into this. So, if we're going to expand to multiple years, some guidance around that would be useful.
Yep.
If you allow me as well, students will be coming from different countries and different. This is a global thing. Which market are we talking about? And definitely the differentiation will be
huge.
Also, I'm a little bit concerned with the composition of the courses, because the courses are going to be, say, created in Canada. I'm not sure whether this is going to fit somebody who's studying business in the Middle East. Definitely the case studies and everything will be targeted there. So this is something that we need to look at, because for me, I want to credit these courses, but it's when I look at them, if I want to make some kind of mapping at the level of the institution, then all the business models and everything doesn't fit in this in my situation. So how am I going to work around this?
This is where the OERu is in a perfect position to do the sort of thing that you're talking about. If you're talking about localizing and contextualizing with that, For example, at my university, we're in the process of developing a new online MBA. We're doing that in partnership with an Australian university. So they're going to teach half, but we're going to teach half. It'll be a dual award. And what we'll be looking at, the unique selling point on this is looking at European business, or supposedly what it's supposed to be looking at, European business approaches and Oceania business approaches. We've got two contrasting approaches with the Far East and then Europe. Now, there's no reason why we couldn't put a third partner or a fourth partner into something like that as it develops. But that's the sort of thing that OERu could be doing.
Yes,
you can contextualize and localize with local case studies, etc.
You might want to bring in a European country into that.
We're ex-European.
Just one thing that's going through my mind, though, is it's whilst on the one hand it's low risk for us to put something into the market, if we put a three-year program into the market which doesn't work for the student, it's not low risk for the student. That's where it does need to be settled. But I mean, I presume if we're putting programs up, they'll be accredited by the individual institutions, that should be okay.
Yes.
But there is, it's not just our risk we need to
be. Yeah, that's what you have to be very careful of, because once you go for a full award that's over more than 1 year, you've got a commitment to the students. You know, you're signing them up for the grade,
yeah.
You've got to look after them for 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
I think one of the things that is really important is that when we develop courses or look for degrees, I believe that if partners can work together to produce this kind of, at the level of the courses themselves, will increase the portability of the courses and the portability of the degree at the end of it. And one of the examples that we have done, we are working with the University of Barcelona in Catalonia. We are working on executive MBA in Islamic banking. They are doing the courses that are related to the MBA. We are doing the courses that are related to the Islamic banking. So because you don't have this knowledge, and we are collaborating together. So I just take this kind of example that when I look at the courses for the baskets that are already there, all the courses have been developed by one institution. I do urge the partners that we work to enrich this by working together more or less, even not at the level of the course, but at the level of these kind of groups of courses to include different perspectives. Yeah, if it is not at the level of the whole program, but at least definitely at the level of the whole program would be perfect, but at the level of the chunks of the program which are consisting of several courses.
Well, a lot of that can be done, for example, at our institution. A student can complete a BBA and only 15 credits have to be TRU credits.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, because we have these block transfer agreements, or we articulate all the transfer courses. Most of our students who go through our online programs, they're not completing all the courses with us. It's they could have gone to 6 different institutions. Right? So it's not. Actually, we already have mechanisms in place to support that idea.
But in your case, you have just only 15% or 15 courses. In my case, is 50% can be transferred, okay? Which is
50% has to be residents.
Yeah,
residential.
Yeah, has to be there. So it's kind of, there are going
variations,
to be different variations.
Yeah.
Variations.
But that's okay.
But the beauty
you don't have to worry about that.
The power of our open design model is there's nothing that restricts us from having the 35% actually working together at the course level.
Absolutely.
There's no restriction whatsoever.
I just got me thinking about, we actually don't have a restriction on how much credit we give for actually related learning. So it goes beyond the course transfer bit, but we'll know it's work experience that translates into credit as well. Yes,
yeah.
But no, we have no restriction right now. But with regards to international accreditation, the Northwest Commission only allows 25%.
We do have restrictions on the non-PAR.
No, in business, we've had students graduate with up to 35%.
Of the 120 credits?
Correct. So, no, it's just, these are some of the nuances with regard. I just cottoned on to when I was thinking about some of the regulations where whereby we actually need to think about some of these things that, that may be nuanced.
If you try to get everybody consistent to the same level, we're not going to get anywhere. So, but what will happen is that the best way for this to happen is actually, if you can get a small number of institutions that are progressive in this area and get a product up and get it running and show that it's working very quickly, the other partners will start to want to come on board. Thompson Rivers are earning $500,000 a year from this. And we're not contributing. I'm thinking, well, why aren't we contributing?
I think that is an excellent strategy. It's kind of like the MVP task force, but it's just focusing on this thing. You know, getting a program up that's going to make money. Mm-hmm. And figure out which institutions want to play that, you know, play that game, and we make it happen.
Yeah, we want to make money.
Good.
And we can make money, and if Thompson Rivers was making $500,000 a year from this, I think some of us would say, you know, we're losing students to Thompson Rivers. We'd better smarten ourselves up. And that's the reality. And it's that idea of, and I've heard it from our faculty, well, we can increase the challenge for credit and do more of that because we'll be bleeding our students. Yeah. And I said, Thompson Rivers will be bleeding our students. Which would you rather have? We get the money or somebody else? Do we want to whine because another university's taking our students, or do we want them to whine about us taking their students?
To pick up on that point, one of the potential issues for this as it gets going is mutual suspicion.
Yes.
Which, is there a role for this group in terms of mitigating that?
I think that's a real driver. Yeah. Is it co-opetition, I think they call it, right?
It's a co-opetition model.
Yeah.
What has worked well for our group today, and we actually have the data to support this, is because it's a transparent discussion. Helps a lot against, because anyone in the group, in the network, can actually see what's being discussed and what's being decided. But it does need the inertia, the drivers, and the leaders to help move it forward.
Yeah. There's so many other things that distinguish us from one another. It's more of a collective action model than anything.
Well, what's rattling through my head, though, is, yeah, and how is any of us going to make $500,000 a year? Because, you know, the thesis of this whole thing is that we work better and more efficiently collaboratively if we can separately, otherwise we'll just do it ourselves, right?
Yeah. The other payback in this model of course is what we produce here in terms of lowering the cost of production of your mainstream business as well. There are clear opportunities there as well. So it's not only on the revenue side, it's about improving efficiencies of the delivery model. And it might even be, and this might sound a bit left brain, but you know, on the one side, you're going for money, the big courses. But the other efficiencies, the long tail, is how you can cost effectively teach traditionally low enrollment courses with this model. And so retain curriculum diversity on campus in affordable ways. So that there's that side to this.
I mean, the other thing we have to remember is that if this goes the way we hope it's going to go, is that as it grows and scales up, there are going to be other sorts of services that are going to be required, like tutoring support, etc. Like some institutions are maybe more progressive than others and they won't offer that. I can even see opportunities of it. I could take half a dozen good, bright students here, put them in a room over there as a support mechanism, and then charge students $10 for the support mechanism.
Like, you know,
tutoring. So there are all sorts of things that
there are, but I guess that's my point. One of the risks is that you do that very successfully, and everybody else says, well, they're making tons of money out of this, but because we've all put stuff in here for free, and this is not fair. And, you know, that kind of thing. I'm having a bit of a flashback because I tried to coordinate physics teaching across the IOU universities in Australia, and God, it's so bloody hard. And all the stuff we've talked about is, oh, but they're all different module sizes, and, you know, the terms don't align, and all the rest of it. So, despite the fact you had 8 universities that couldn't profitably teach physics, I couldn't even persuade them to put a grant in to the government to get money to fund it. It's just so frustrating.
Wow, yeah. Yeah.
So anyway, I'm not...
One of the differences is that you were getting to say you were making $500,000 from tutoring support, right? I mean, just tutoring a hell of a lot of students.
Yeah.
What are those students doing? They're doing modules. Who's providing those modules? They could be taking your modules or there's nothing to stop it in the cooperation type of environment we're in to say, no, there doesn't have to be just one provider of support for students, because they may find they want an Australian support model rather than a UK, something like that.
Well, we're just having a side conversation about parallels in the software industry, but they've done round the support models
with like follow the Samsung.
Yeah.
Big advantage for our network, yeah.
And those are all, to me, those are all
really, availability.
They're secondary sources of income. No, the primary source of income is from the courses itself and doing the assessment.
So, I mean, part of, you know, I'm just thinking as we're talking, but
that's good. It's better than talking without thinking.
Oh, not always. For this group to be able to, you know, at least provide the strands of intelligence so people know what's going on and there's some sense of shared service around it, other than just the team executives.
I think there is, but the beauty of this model is we can cooperate as much as we want and more, or we can cooperate a little bit, and that's fine too. And it's up to each institution to look at it from their point of view. But I don't know. I mean, I would think that if our university started to make a lot of money out of this, and we thought we didn't need the OERU, maybe we wouldn't continue with it. But we're in the OERU because we believe there's some benefit to it. It's not just an altruistic benefit. I believe that there's a lot of money to be made out of this.
I mean, we're in this for a number of reasons, which I alluded to earlier. One of them is about trying to get an income. Now, I'm not completely daft. I don't think we're going to make a huge amount out of this. Although I'll be happy to be proved wrong. I'll be delighted with that. But for my institution, it's not just about making the money as well. It's about those international links with universities and colleges and things that are like-minded that want, and out of that, other things can come as well.
Good ideas.
So it's putting the university in an international context from a teaching perspective rather than just a research perspective all the time.
But I see the indirect thing is that students who come to us for the exam, that some of them will become our regular students and go on that way.
There's so many ways that this could be pitched. I mean, I for example, I was talking to some faculty about this idea, and I mentioned the Indigenous study. No, what was it? The Aboriginal, no. Australian history? Australian study?
Indigenous Australian
history, is it? Studies. Well, which is something we are offered here. Which is kind of, I mean, I'd have to take that course. You know, I mean, I was talking to somebody else was saying, well, you know, we send a lot of students, we study abroad is a big part of what we do. I'm sure you all have studied abroad programs. Many of our students go to Australia. That could be something we could say to a student, hey, you know, you're thinking of going to Australia, take this course. Learn about Australia. Learn about where you're going, you know. And then that transfers back into the, whatever the degree or program they happen to be already in. There's so many ways, permutations this can go.
Virtual study abroad.
Is
it Microsoft certified program? Yes. It's not a university qualification. It's a commercial credential, and yet it's regarded more highly than most degrees are, or something about that. Yeah. You know, it's got a really good standing.
Well, only by people who don't know anything.
Here's an idea for you. This is where the OERU network can fit in really. If you've got an idea, said, right, let's develop a course for computer scientists that's X length. It may not be a degree. It shouldn't be a degree. Something like that. And we say that actually, between five or six of us, we have enough content that we could contribute something that the commercial world wants. You have some discussions with people.
Okay, well, we have a master of project management, and we are mapping our courses with that, where the most of the courses, when they finish, they just only take additional 2 or 3 modules, and then they go ahead with the exam, and they recognize the learning that happened during the master.
Can I just see if I can sum up one of the points of difference that this has emerged here, and just make sure I'm writing something down that's valid, as far as you're all concerned. One of the points of difference of this network or advantages that we offer is the idea that all of the members of the network can benefit from opportunities identified by any of the members of the network. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
Because by virtue of any one of the members taking an initiative that then proves to be successful, the other members can more rapidly also enter that or take advantage of that opportunity
should they choose to.
Because, for example, they don't have to write their own materials. They can use the ones that have them. Okay, so that's a fair thing to say.
Non-members could also take advantage of that opportunity, right?
Sure can. That's true. Yeah. They won't have the inside running. They won't be familiar with how it all works.
And that's also one of the big advantages of this is sort of the first market people are this is really the tacit knowledge that folk get out doing this. Because that's what you can plow back into the institution back at home. So it's kind of this low risk type of model. You learn it because the way we do things is different to how things normally run on campus. And there are valuable insights of that process that you plow back into your own efficiency, even if the campus bit is still closed. You see what I'm saying? Yeah.
I mean, this completely mirrors the open source software development model where it's completely based on the enlightened self-interest of each participant, with the recognition that the materials that each participant contributes increase in value the more other people that are vetting them and looking at them, and by contributing things to the group, you effectively as an individual institution reduce your own risk and your own costs because other members of the group will have an interest in making sure that they're valid and up to date and various other things. So you essentially reduce your risk and your costs overall by participating.
And to pick up what you learn, you learn through engagement.
Yeah.
I mean, but again, it's the individuals who tend to the ones who show up. Really? The institutions.
Partners will know how to participate and how to leverage the valuable things that the network provides, whereas others may not, or they will, and it will be clangingly inappropriate the way they do it, and they'll perhaps be shunned.
And I mean, institutions are collections of individuals.
Yeah.
As I like to point out, if you can say the university should, or the UN.
An institution has test knowledge because someone in the institution has that knowledge.
Right. But the institution itself doesn't walk around and can't have applying that knowledge.
It can't have ethics, it can't have anything. Repetition, but can't repetition.
Yeah. We answer all the questions.
So agreed that the terms of reference would evolve out of makeup of the committee or board or whatever we're calling group.
Kind of what I'm hearing is clearly the academic board is not the thing that we need.
Yes. But it's called a group now, not a board.
But yeah, it's a group, and I think there needs to be discussion around the terms of reference. I think there needs to be the small group of institutions that are wanting to help lead this process forward, take it to the next steps and figure out what it is this thing is going to be doing.
Yeah, because I think we've really identified two separate groups. One that you suggested might be this more of the strategic one, doing the 5-year plans for OERU, and the other one, if we're still thinking about it, the one that goes out to the institutions and helps them to implement.
Yeah.
Which they're advising in very different directions.
Right.
To whether that can be the same group or separate.
Yeah.
So the strategy group, is that, what does that have as part of its?
So, current to date, what the strategy group has been doing has really been working on the consultation of the development of the strategic plan and then the monitoring piece. I mean, it's not overly sophisticated, but you know, it's just having a look at the KPIs each year, calibrating them, communicating with the VCs. There's like, I think, two reports that go out every year. So that's kind of what the strategy group has been doing, but hasn't really been having sort of the kinds of discussion that Clive and yourself have been thinking about, you know, some of the more in-depth sort of business thinking, you know, prioritization. It hasn't really been doing that sort of work, in part because, you know, the people aren't there to do it.
So it hasn't looked at curriculum or program planning?
No. There was a, we had a curriculum and program planning group, but which hasn't been that successful. It was good to get things moving. Because we started with nothing, right? And I think the smorgasbord approach has actually worked well initially, because we've got a suite of courses now. We actually do have sufficient courses, and that was a smorgasbord approach. Because you could see, okay, here are a bunch of courses, you've got these, well, let's have a look around now which credentials out there within the network that this fits to. So it was kind of this bottom-up thing, but we do need to become more focused now.
So it was last night's dinner kind of in that.
Yeah.
I'm just conscious of the fact that, you know, every time you have an annual meeting, and this is my first time, and I think for many of us around the table, it's our first time, you know, really getting into the nitty-gritty parts of what this is all about. But I'm also conscious of the fact that next year it might not be me, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, the TRU as a partner is part of the consortium, if you want to call it that, but the representatives that are at the table here immediately engaged may not be the same people next year.
Yeah.
So we need to be, I'm just, when we talk about terms of reference or some sort of description of what these committees or groups do, I think that's important because the makeup of the people, the makeup of the groups is going to change.
Absolutely.
Right?
And this is where the open source model helps us tremendously because we keep that transparent record of every decision that is made.
Yeah.
So in theory, any new person coming in can actually search, find out,
get caught up
and see. And that helps us tremendously because, you're right, there's this kind of turnover type of thing, different people at each meeting. Yeah.
Churn.
Which I think is refreshing because it brings new ideas, new individuals.
Absolutely.
It's also a challenge.
Are we redoing everything? Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, we were conscious of that in our group last time because people who had been to last year's meeting said, oh, well, we did that last year. Like, oh, okay. Many of us didn't even know that.
But it's valuable. You've got a couple more people going back into the institution that know more about the network.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. As long as you have people who know the lore and can point people towards it when they know that something has already been discussed, it's very valuable. It's hard to know the significance of things.
That was a theme that came out of the discussion this morning, which was that we kind of felt that there wasn't enough of that, and maybe that's because we, those of us who are not steeped in the history, haven't read enough of it.
Sure.
But
then we need a cheat sheet.
Well, I was just wondering about that. I was just wondering, you know, open source software, are there analogies there, or, you know, is there a role that crawls through the wiki and all that?
Normally what happens is you get people who are kind of sort of taking an anthropological role within a community, and they tend to be the storytellers for it, and they have there's the odd seminal blog post or something that will help to set the stage for someone's participation in a particular community. And what we need to do is perhaps we need to identify bards for our movement and have them
perhaps musicians.
we also need that kind of that induction course thing, you know, like 3 hours to get up to speed with OERu. We really need that. Yeah.
So
there's just layers and layers and layers of material that it's just almost impossible as a newbie. You know, just saying coming in, I was like, well, I was saying one day I had an hour. I thought, well, I'll just sit down and I'll just catch up. And I thought, oh my God, I'm going to need a week to go through this stuff. There's no way. And I thought, oh, well, I'll do it while I'm in the airport. 6 hours later, I was still reading.
Yep, a lot has happened.
I mean, I guess the other thing is that is as things crystallise as we actually get the up, there'll be a sense of sublimity that's probably missing from in fact, they haven't previously done everything that is needed to be done in terms of the credit transfer. So.
Yep. We should break for lunch.
I like that bar idea. So, you know, it's actually, if you look at the traditional culture in Australia,
well,
it was all song lines. Yeah.
It's all educational. It's all.
Yeah.
Not long ago, no one just about.
Yeah.
The other thing we should look at is having an apprenticeship for bringing, you know, having people that are involved in and the board bringing in inductees or new, you know,
yes, there we go.